Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Prophet of Kindness. How to influence others, establish trust, and build lasting business relationships. Jill Lublin. Narrated by Karen Saltus. Introduction. Move over, Cash. There's a new king in town. ASF. Always serve first. James Malinchak, motivational speaker. It was go time. I'd spent a year heavily investing in my career. Time, money, networking, and lots of training enabled me to update and redesign my workshops and presentations, website, and promotional materials. Mark LeBlanc, who had been the president of the National Speakers Association, was working with me one-on-one as a coach. As a result of my work, focus, and sacrifice, it was all coming together. My schedule was jammed with speaking engagements. New consulting clients were streaming in. My profile expanded, as did my reach. I had even been invited to speak at an intense 3-day business conference on an island off the coast of Vancouver, British Columbia. I emerged from the ferry, pulling my trusty roller bag, to meet a nasty Canadian storm. The air was filled with an icy chill, and my entire body hurt from the exhaustion of presenting all day. Back on terra firma, I plowed through the pouring rain and freezing wind hammering my face. All I could think of was finding the driver of the town car and getting warm. A few feet from the sleek black automobile, I greeted the driver and moved with my luggage toward the trunk when my feet flew out from under me and everything went black. My next memory is waking up in a hospital the next day. My brain was foggy, while bolts of pain radiated from my ankles, both of which were fractured in multiple places. I was immobilized, bedridden. I went from go time to stop short. In just one night, my life drastically changed, and I quickly moved past depressed and settled comfortably into despondent. My carefully laid out plans collapsed, my income was sucked dry, and my burgeoning reputation vanished. Instead of going from city to city, event to event, and being showered with thanks, compliments, and recognition, I was confined within the walls of my home. And to make matters worse, I became heavily dependent on others for managing even the most routine things in life because I couldn't walk, drive, cook, or bathe myself. There I was, stuck in bed, flat on my back with both legs elevated. No matter what I tried, I couldn't get comfortable. I was fidgety, frustrated, bored, and miserable. Once the brain fog cleared, I called Mark LeBlanc to cancel our upcoming coaching session. I couldn't concentrate, so coaching would be a waste. Plus, I no longer had a business and couldn't afford our sessions any longer. Everything would have to be put on hold, I told him. I won't hear of it, Mark barked in response. Our sessions will continue, and don't worry about payment until you are back on your feet. Literally. I didn't see it then, but Mark's savviness and instincts helped him realize that at such a difficult time, I was fragile. I needed more than business coaching, and he stepped up to help me work through my depression and figure out how to be as productive as possible while I healed. In turn, our sessions were highly productive. We planned for the future, preparing for my return. We focused on maximizing my downtime, minimizing my losses, picking up the pieces, and reclaiming all I thought I had lost. Gently and patiently, Mark guided me, and that's when the gains started. I learned how to use my time effectively so I would be ready when it was time to resume my career. He gave me suggestions and support. He kept me busy. His unsolicited kindness and generosity overwhelmed me. His humanity pulled me out of my funk. Mark's professional support was a game changer for me, but his kindness and compassion had an even greater, more meaningful impact. Although I had always prided myself on being kind and giving, Mark's generosity spurred me to kick kindness into high gear. Once my regularly scheduled life resumed, I made it a priority to consistently try to be kinder, more patient, a better communicator, and more compassionate and understanding in both my business and personal lives. Later in the audiobook, I discuss how the two go hand in hand. I also tried to become more observant, looking for opportunities in which I could give, and give generously, without expecting anything in return. Kindness, a business contradiction, or useful convention? Doing hard work, providing highly skilled services, innovating a product or opening a business while expecting nothing in return is typically viewed as a contradiction to profitable operations. This is why when Mark went without compensation for the hours of expertise he patiently lent me without asking for anything in return, I was humbled. He provided an example I knew I wanted to follow, and it made me think. I wanted people to feel about me the way I felt about Mark, whom I considered admirable, trustworthy, loyal, grounded, and well-rounded. Basically, somebody you want to invite into your life and stay there. Mark's graciousness planted the seeds that blossomed into what helped me make great gains in my business. Gains I call the profit of kindness. The no-strings-attached business transactions based in and centered on kindness, which ultimately leads to the payment of dividends in the form of increased profit, revenues, customers, connectivity, prospects. How do I know? Because Mark's largesse cemented our relationship and my loyalty to him. And to this day, that loyalty compels me to continue to employ him as my business coach and advisor. I credit him every chance I get and recommend his services and sell copies of his book wherever I go. I like to think that the kindness currency that Mark paid me during my most challenging time has paid off for him tenfold in the areas noted in the previous list, through my referrals and book sales. What I do know for sure is that the inspiration I personally received from Mark, which ultimately led me to implement kindness as currency in my own business, has led me to grow and flourish professionally and personally in ways I never dreamed possible. It is now a business convention that I strictly adhere to and teach. Consider the profit of kindness a new kind of payment plan, one to which you commit yourself and your business in order to build equity in yourself, others, your goods and/or services, and your future. It is a plan based on 7 pathways that generates returns on building trusting, long-lasting relationships through open, non-adversarial interfaces and exchanges that result in mutually beneficial outcomes. It's acting amiably, considerately, and treating others, even competitors, with dignity and respect, exactly as you would like them to treat you. It's about giving and expecting nothing in return, and gaining substantially because of it. In business, kindness would be considered one of those soft skills, probably one that we think we don't have time for, whether we are a busy corporate executive or an understaffed entrepreneur. We are running through our days, multitasking, distracted by technology and busy work, or reeling through the demands and stressors of work-life balance that we can't seem to get a grip on. As we stay focused on the business elements that we think matter, like tasks and productivity and time management, we are unknowingly detracting from our efforts because we are not prioritizing the necessary component of success. Dr. Stephen Covey famously wrote an article called The Big Rocks of Life. In it, he tells the story of a professor who pulled out a 1-gallon glass mason jar and filled it with fist-sized rocks. Once he reached the tip-top of the jar, he asked his class whether the jar was full. "Yes," they answered in unison. Then the professor grabbed a hidden stash of gravel and began to pour it in the mason jar. As the sand and pebbles began to sliver through the cracks and crevices of the large rocks, the class began to murmur. They knew the answer to his next question. "Is the jar full now?" would be no. And this time the class was right. So the professor took a pitcher of water and began to pour it into the mason jar until it reached the brim. When he was finished, he proclaimed the jar finally full. "What is the moral of this illustration?" asked the professor. The point is, no matter how full your schedule is, if you try really hard, you can always fit some more things into it, answered one zealous student.
No, the professor replied, that's not the point.
The truth this illustration teaches us is, if you don't put the big rocks in first, you'll never get them in at all. What are the big rocks in your business? It is my contention that when building our brands and businesses, and in order to target and increase the big five results, profit, revenues, customers, connectivity, and prospects, our big rocks should not be built upon the typical business modalities, as they too often are. Instead, this audiobook teaches that our big rocks are the solid masses only kindness can accumulate. Rock upon rock becomes the bedrock of business that holds us accountable to paying out and receiving kindness currency. In business, we must always start with kindness, and only after kindness is written into the institution of the business can it be filled to the brim with all the other good stuff. What I set out to do throughout this audiobook is help business owners, entrepreneurs, and executives notice if the important rocks of kindness have been missing from their business model. And if they have, my 7 pathways to generating kindness currency will help to turn everything around. Before I lay the foundation for the 7 pathways, let's get one thing straight about kindness. It is simple, but not easy. What is kindness? Kindness, in all of its simplicity, is a loaded word. It's a catch term for a host of other traits, behaviors, emotions, and actions, which must be exhibited on a daily basis in order to cash in on kindness. Just as we pay for goods and services using cash, credit, and even barter, kindness currency varies. So let's expand its definition by offering the many characteristics of kindness, the very characteristics that make up the 7 pathways to profit. Compassion, flexibility, patience, positivity, generosity, gratitude, and connection. These pathways can be used alone or in tandem to increase the big five: profit, revenues, customers, connectivity, and prospects. Through case studies and research, this audiobook adds context to kindness while expanding its definition, helping you begin to brainstorm each kindness characteristic as a pathway to your own business goals. Throughout this audiobook, you will hear from executives turned consultants, business owners, entrepreneurs, and angel investors who have profited from the currency of kindness. You will learn how kindness became a differentiator that set businesses apart from their competition, sparked new ideas for goods and services, helped retain quality staff, and even landed free advertising. Research peppered throughout the audiobook aims to justify the use of kindness currency in all its forms, and case studies illustrate each kindness currency in action. From the compassion a boss showed a new employee, to competitors coming together to mentor one another, to the grocery store with a no-questions-asked return policy, and so on, you will be inspired, motivated, and armed with the tools you need to make kindness key in your business. Unfortunately, many people believe that they must be hard, tough, and unyielding in order to succeed, compete, or belong. They think they have to appear to be strong, decisive, and self-assured, anything but being a softy who shows gentle kindness. So they don heavy armor and prepare for battle. Many justify their hard-edged behavior on the grounds that business is dog-eat-dog, or that only the strong survive. As we will explore in later chapters, the irony is that playing roles that go against our character usually backfire. When we try to be what we're not, we rarely do anything very well. By not identifying and capitalizing on our inner strengths, those soft characteristics that make us human, and the advantages they provide, we don't put our best foot forward or use our greatest assets. We hold ourselves back by not using the special qualities that distinguish us from the pack and could help us leverage our ideas and expand our approaches and overall influence. Unkind business tactics have many drawbacks. They can easily get out of hand. And in today's social media world, nobody can afford to make a false move.
Plus, bad business can become excessive, habitual, and extend beyond the workplace. Harsh practices can spill over into other facets of our lives, including our homes and families, which can only be detrimental to our well-being, our spirits, our physical health, our hearts, and our wallets. Two cases of kindness. Ben and Dawn wanted to get into the movie business, so they started Saturday Night at the Movies, which showed previously released movies at a hall in Northern California. Each week, they paired two outstanding films, usually classics, which viewers may have missed or wanted to see again. Occasionally, Ben and Dawn invited local film aficionados to lead discussions. For one showing, they invited Charles Champlin, the Los Angeles Times' chief film critic. Ben and Dawn also convinced their friend Sheila Benson, a local part-time film reviewer, to introduce Champlin to the audience. A warm, generous, hard-working, single mother of three who juggled various jobs, Sheila was always pressed for time. However, when her friends asked, she rearranged her crazy schedule and even made time to go to the airport with Ben to pick up Champlin so she could get to know him. As the trio was driving from the airport, Ben's car ran out of gas. Ben was forced to abandon Charles and Sheila in search of a gas station. While he was gone, Champlin and Benson talked about movies nonstop, barely noticing that Ben was gone. They got along well, built strong mutual respect, and after that weekend, Charles and Sheila kept in touch. Several months later, Charles announced his retirement from the Times and recommended Sheila to be his successor. As a result of her kindness and for going to great lengths to help her friends, Sheila became the Los Angeles Times' top film critic, a life-affirming position that she held for a decade, and she didn't have to take on any other jobs. No more juggling, no more maniacal schedules. She had stability. Devin's appointment to head the city's high-profile housing project was controversial. No one doubted his engineering and administrative expertise, but they wondered whether Devin's negotiation skills were good enough. The housing project, the city's biggest and costliest development to date, was bogged down in a series of disputes and delays between the city and its labor unions. Coyle, a tough, bombastic veteran negotiator, was the union spokesman and the main thorn in the city's side. A dynamic leader and media darling, Coyle flamboyantly made outrageous claims, unreasonable demands, and refused to budge. His style was to constantly scream, harangue, and wage all-out war to get his way. Before starting work, Devin met with the mayor, who outlined the project's history, briefed him on all the players, and stressed how difficult it was to deal with Coyle. "He always gives you a headache," the mayor explained. "The only way to deal with him is to scream at him before he screams at you. Otherwise, he'll think you're weak and eat you alive." Devin listened to the mayor's advice, but shouting and carrying on was not his way. So he decided he had to be himself and act naturally. So when Devin spoke with Coyle, he let Coyle rant, rave, and demand. He didn't interrupt, argue, or get into shouting matches, but calmly and firmly stated and stuck to his own position. Throughout the course of the weeks-long negotiations, Devin made it a point to ask Coyle personal questions such as, "How is your family? Did you have a good weekend? And how did you like that game?" Although Coyle briskly brushed off Devin's inquiries, Devin persisted being kind, friendly, and warm. As the weeks wore on, Coyle slowly softened and became more reasonable. Negotiations progressed, agreements were made, the project moved forward, and it was eventually completed. When Coyle was asked why, after all these years, he had changed his trademark tactics, he replied, "Devin wore me down. It was like punching a pillow, and after a while it made no sense. It was clear that I was dealing with a kind, reasonable man who only wanted to get a fair deal that worked for all, and basically that's what I wanted too. When I realized that, working it all out was easy." These are just two examples of how currencies like compassion and positive, respectful communication can pay off big time in business. Sheila knew how badly her friends needed her, especially as they entered a competitive industry in a saturated market. If it weren't for her compassion for the hurdles her friends were trying to jump, she would never have put herself in a position to meet Charles Champlin. Sheila depended on multiple jobs to make ends meet, but when she turned paying opportunities down and rearranged her commitments in order to help her friends, she was paid back in remarkable ways. Similarly, Devin committed to remaining authentic to his core values of kindness and respect, despite the advice of the city's mayor. By relying on his own humanity, Devin was able to find common ground with a jaded union spokesman. They were both passionate and caring people in the business of doing what they thought right and necessary. To many people's surprise, Devin proved himself to be not only prudent, but powerful. Sheila and Devin found themselves in very different positions than when they first started, and that is because they positioned themselves by leading with kindness first. Their rocks of compassion and positive, respectful communication led to high returns on kindness, a return on kindness like no other. The Return on Kindness, ROK. Plan, 7 Pathways to Profit. I previously mentioned that generating kindness currency can happen by focusing on 7 character traits or 7 pathways. These steps do not need to be done in any particular order, and what is even greater about them is you can reap the benefits immediately by just implementing 1 or 2. No need to do all of them right out of the gate. As you think about your business model and consider where kindness currency can be spent, you might find that your business is already sufficiently doused in 1 or 2 traits while you want to focus on building more equity in other areas. It is a personal plan and is customizable to your business, one that you can hone and reassess quarterly as you do your financial and incremental goals. Each chapter of this audiobook focuses on defining and expanding on each of the 7 ROK pathways: compassion, flexibility, patience, positivity, generosity, gratitude, and connection. Are these the same as the previous 7 pathways? If so, they are different. Please advise. Additionally, you will read about research and case studies, as well as receive expert advice on how to utilize each of the ROK pathways in one's business, specifically focusing on how each ROK pathway has an effect on the Big 5: profit, revenues, customers, connectivity, and prospects. The profit of kindness is not an ideological view of business. It is a strategy that works, and when committed, it will not let you down. It has become my mission to change that centuries-old idea of the out-for-herself human being that for so long has influenced our fundamental view of business and leadership. When I began speaking about the kindness currency and the 7 ROK pathways, I was a little nervous. Of course, I was afraid I would be laughed off the podium. But what has struck me is the sincere attention and grateful responses of clients, audiences, colleagues, and peers. They have all clicked with the importance of the characteristics that make us good citizens and have shown eagerness to learn more about the empirical business benefits of going soft. Recently, I picked up the book How to Be Alive, A Guide to the Kind of Happiness That Helps the World by Colin Bevan, and was struck by something he wrote. The world needs entrepreneurs who use business as a tool for increasing happiness. It needs activists who speak with love instead of fear and anger. It needs gardeners and local farmers who care for the land. It needs a whole different kind of bankers and politicians who care more about communities than corporations. It also needs more musicians on the subway platforms and artists on the streets to bring us joy in these difficult times. The world needs so much. It needs all of us. This audiobook is about us, all of us, and how we choose to redefine business for all mankind. So let's get started. Chapter 1: The Case for Kindness. In business, trust and authenticity are perhaps the most important currencies. Mats Lederhausen. When you decide to get into business, you begin swimming with the sharks. Therefore, every business decision, idea, innovation, and communication is based on staying alive in those infested waters. Except I don't agree. My version of doing good business looks less like bloody shark-infested waters and more like a Finding Nemo movie, where all species come together, making for a magical, harmonious, colorful, fun experience, and always with a great lesson at the end. The lesson I have learned throughout my work as a publicity strategist and consultant to hundreds of entrepreneurial and corporate clients is this. We are not sharks, not even close. When you think about your business model and how kindness fits in, we must start with being clear on how to be good to people and still make money. Or do you believe you need to be harsh with people, use network connections, manipulate customers, or have bad blood with vendors in order to keep your shingle out? Not the latter, of course. After all, what person actually wants to invite that kind of drama as a practical business strategy? This audiobook stands as my firm belief that kindness manifests in prospects, connectivity, customers, and yes, sales, which means profits and a successful business, large or small, scalable and sustainable. Through years of meeting different types of business people and helping them develop positive and impactful publicity and media relationships, I've come to understand more about why we should choose kindness in business over the traditional dog-eat-dog acumen. Digging around in Darwinism will reveal the survival of the fittest theory, but it turns out we are wired for much more than tearing the eyes out of the weak. Built into our human DNA is the desire and need to bond, to connect in deep, meaningful ways. And I believe that connectivity of all things is the most critical component of successful business, because without trustworthy and loyal relationships, it is impossible to be in business. In Driven to Lead, Good, Bad, and Misguided Leadership, Harvard Business School's Paul R. Lawrence agrees when he writes, "We are designed to accomplish things in groups, to lead and follow, to learn from each other, to trust and protect and care for each other, to acquire what we need collectively, even if we then enjoy it individually. We have evolved this way because it turned out to be a very successful means of survival." To devour the weak might be instinctual, but humans thankfully have evolved by working cooperatively, relying on problem-solving skills instead of raw instinct. Lawrence explains that this is a pretty good working definition of leadership. Surviving by solving new problems as they come up using a plethora of avenues and ideas is considered good leadership. What we need to survive as good leaders, beyond the two basic needs described by Abraham Maslow, sustenance and safety, are community and understanding. It is a basic human drive, a survival need to work together harmoniously, and at its most simple level, to be kind. Acknowledging the latter two of the four needs, Paul Lawrence says it is not only a snapshot for what is going on, it is also a blueprint for deciding what to do next at the helm of our business, because it is a blueprint for leadership. Our species couldn't have survived if it weren't compelled to find food and avoid harm. But the existence of a drive to bond, to seek social bonds, attachments, and commitments played a major role, and still does to this day. I believe good leaders are led by their desire to bond. Connectivity with our clients, our patrons, our customers, and our competitors is a major pillar in good business, no matter how big or small. To be connected means to exercise acts of kindness consciously until they become unconscious natural behaviors, as well as institutionalized in the business model, philosophy, mission, and atmosphere themselves. The drive to bond lends to this connectivity if kindness is enmeshed in the walls of the building and the hearts of its people. When it comes to examples of profits, the dollars and cents kind, as well as the wealth that is generated through fulfillment and service to others, I will be pointing to many anecdotal examples that I've come across in my work as a marketing advisor to small businesses and corporations throughout the past several decades. The people I will introduce you to in this audiobook have demonstrated to me that the way toward profits, scalability, growth, and iconoclastic status is by connecting with people through the seemingly soft yet underestimated skill of kindness. What kindness isn't? Maybe right now you're thinking to yourself, kindness? Really? The last Harvard Business School class reunion didn't include a handheld circle of MBAs singing Kumbaya. Maybe not, but the cream of the corporate crop has always known that a smart business strategy includes how customers are treated and perceived to be treated. In his article in the Harvard Business Review, Jeffrey F. Rayport writes about what was introduced by the review 2 decades ago as service recovery, a company's ability to respond quickly, decisively, and effectively to a service problem of its own making. For example, Rayport cites how Ritz-Carlton hotels are famous for making every problem into what the company calls an opportunity, and has proven to be a powerful way to increase loyalty among existing customers. Writes Rayport, here's how it works. When a problem occurs, swift and effective resolution can elevate repurchase intent to a level that's actually greater than if the problem had never occurred at all. Every problem, if managed well, is thus an opportunity to boost overall loyalty among a company's already loyal customers. Spill soup on a guest in the hotel dining room? Solution: offer on the spot to dry clean the suit, or, if the damage is severe, offer to replace it entirely. The customer is delighted. The employee has done the right thing. The hotel raises that customer's lifetime value. However, kindness is not saying please and thank you, or offering complimentary valet services, or hosting an annual holiday party, or making reparations for a clumsy waiter or rude receptionist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.